Actually, I'll talk about laboratory organization and operations today. Laboratory organization is very similar to hospital organization. The topmost position after the promoters and owner of laboratory, the topmost position is of lab director. There is a quality manager who look after quality of the laboratory, and quality manager report directly to the lab director. There is a supporting staff and line staff similar to that in hospital or any other organization. The supporting staff include accounting staff, administration staff, biomedical waste in charge, marketing and housekeeping staff. These are all required if you run a standalone laboratory. If your clinical laboratory is a part of hospital, then the supporting staff will be same as that of hospital. But if you have a standalone laboratory, then you need all these supporting staff. Then there is a line staff. The laboratory, although appear as a single department in a tertiary care hospital or some other hospital, but it has various sections in it. So there are various head of various sections who take care of sections like biochemistry, microbiology, cytology, histopathology, hematology. So these are various sections, and there are head of sections. Under these head of sections, there are senior residents, junior residents, and technical staff. Technical staff is organized as technical assistant, technical supervisor, lab technician, lab assistant, and lab attendant. So this is about the laboratory organization. Now we will go through the laboratory operation. So this is a global picture of laboratory operations. It starts with patient and the treating physician, and it is like a cycle which end up where it starts. So we will take these steps in a sequential manner. So the first step is a patient come to a physician, a treating physician examine the patient clinically and arrive at a probable diagnosis. So diagnosis is not confirmed, diagnosis is not certain. To confirm the diagnosis, the treating physician requests certain laboratory tests. In case of hospital, the phlebotomy is outside a clinical laboratory. Blood is drawn from the patient and the sample is transported to a laboratory. So this part of cycle of laboratory operation is outside laboratory. So it is difficult to control. If something wrong happens at one of these steps which are outside the laboratory, it is very difficult to rectify those steps, because it is possible. We can train the phlebotomist. We can also educate the treating physician, but the things are difficult here because these steps are outside a laboratory. Then inside the laboratory, the steps are divided into three: pre-analytical phase, analytical phase, and post-analytical phase. In pre-analytical phase, which include the entire sequence from the patient to the reception of a laboratory where a lab number is assigned to sample. So all the steps starting from the patient, when physician requests, demands certain blood test or some other body fluid or some other sample test, from that point to the reception of lab, is the pre-analytical phase. At laboratory reception, the sample and the test requisition form are examined, and if there is any discrepancy or any confusion, or if sample is not of optimal quality, optimal quantity, and or not in a proper vial, then the sample is rejected. So every lab have a sample rejection policy. So this is about the analytical phase. Then comes the analytical phase. In analytical phase, sample is analyzed. Analysis is partly manual and partly automatic. Sometimes it is fully automated. So it depends on the type of analyzers we have. After the analysis, the rest of the steps are post-analytic. And before analysis, the steps are pre-analytical. So after analysis, the data is entered into the register or into the computer. By data, I mean patient-related information and test results. So these are entered in computer. So let us go a little bit detail about post-analytical phase. So post-analytical phase starts after the analysis, and it includes data entry into the register or computer. Then report is generated. Report mostly nowadays are generated automatically by our software in computer, or it may be a handwritten report. The report after generation is validated, and this report validation is usually done by a postgraduate person. It may be a pathologist or a microbiologist or biochemist. The person may be MSc in biochemistry, medical biochemistry. The person may be MSc in microbiology. Such qualified person validates the report. So report validation is done by the three procedures we can do report validation. The one is delta check. By delta check, I mean patient's previous reports are compared with the current result. And if the change in the result is explained by patient condition, the report is validated. Then the second procedure is correlation check. In correlation check, one of the patient tests is correlated with some other test. For example, blood urea is correlated with serum creatinine, and HbA1c is correlated with blood sugar value. So this kind of correlations, this is known as correlation check. So we validate the report using correlation check. And the third is the clinical history. We look at the clinical history of the patient, and if report results of the report agree with the clinical history, we validate the report. So there are these three procedures by which we can validate the report. Then the report is dispatched to either the patient address or location, or to the clinician who requested the test. So the report is dispatched to the correct person after correct identification of the patient and or clinician who requested the report. Report is not handled, handed over to any other person. So this is about laboratory operations. Thank you very much.